Okay, let's get started. Welcome to the press conference at the Foreign Correspondents Club of Japan. My name is Tetsuo Jimbo. I'm a long-time member here and chairman of the Professional Activities Committee. And our speaker today is Mr. Hiroaki Koide, former assistant professor of Kyoto University. And actually, we've been asking Mr. Koide to come to our club to speak for a long time, but he's been always busy and he hasn't been able to come. But finally, I'm very happy to have him today with us. Mr. Koide is a long-time nuclear scientist, but he's one of the very rare species, as you know, in Japan, in Japan's so-called nuclear village, because he says he studies the nuclear science not to promote the nuclear technology, but to study, to learn the danger of the nuclear technology. And since the Fukushima Daiichi accident 4 years ago, Mr. Koide has appeared in thousands of new lecture events and interviews. But for some reason, I don't see him much on TV and newspapers. I wonder why that is. But anyway, he's 65 years old, and he has just retired from the Kyoto University, where he has worked for 41 years. And he may be retiring from the Kyoto University, but I am very sure that he's not really retiring. I'm sure he's going to tell us what he's going to do after Kyoto. So ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Mr. Hiroaki Koide.
Thank you very much. I am Hiroaki Koide, a former assistant professor of Kyoto University. Thank you gathering for this place. I'm sorry, I'm bad at English speech, so I asked Ms. Takamas to interpret my speech. Let's start my speech. Yeah. Fukushima 第一原子力発電所の事故からすでに4年が経ってしまいました。日本政府あるいは東京電力の発表する報道というのは非常に限られたものだし、誤りに満ちたものだと私は思ってきました。今日は福島の現状がどうなっているかということをかいつまんで聞いていただこうと思います。
So as you can see from the title of my presentation, 4 years have passed since the Fukushima number one power plant accident occurred. Since that time, we've received many, many announcements from the Japanese government and from TEPCO. But my impression is that the announcements are very limited in nature and that they are contain many, many errors. So today I'd like to describe for you the actual situation regarding Fukushima.
ご存知と思いますが、これが事故を起こした福島第一原子力発電所の写真です。
As you can see, this is a photo of
一番右にあるのが1号機、次が2号機、次が3号機です。あ、ごめんなさい。
So as you can see, this is the aerial photograph of the Fukushima number one power plant. Starting from the right-hand side, we see unit number one, and moving towards the left, we see two, three, and four. I'm sorry, I skipped a slide. I'm going to go back.
One 号機、二号機、三号機は2011年3月11日に運転中でした。
As you know, when units number 1, 2, and 3 were actually in operation when the earthquake hit on
March 3rd, 2011.
Units number 1 and 3 were operating at that time, and when the earthquake and then the tsunami hit, set off a series of events where the reactor core actually melted, and during the process of this melting, a great deal of hydrogen was emitted into the air, and as a result, there was a hydrogen explosion, and as you can see, the reactor buildings themselves have been severely damaged.
一番左にあるのが4号機 ですが、これは2011年3月11日に運転していませんでした。すべての燃料も炉心にはありませんでした。そのため炉心が溶けるということはなかったのですが、なぜかこの原子炉建屋でも水素爆発が起きまして、このように建屋が吹き飛んでしまいました。
Over on the left hand side we see unit number 4. You can see that the reactor building has been very much destroyed. However, unit number 4 was not operating on March 11th, 2011, so there was no nuclear fuel in the reactor core. So the events that I just described for you for units 1 and 3, in other words, the melting of the reactor core, did not occur for unit number 4. In spite of this, however, for some reason, there was a similar hydrogen explosion, and as you can see, the reactor building was severely damaged.
4号機の燃料は炉心から取り出されて、使用済み燃料プールというプールの底に移されていたのですが、そのプールは今この写真で写っている原子炉建屋のすべて壁が抜けてしまった4階という階に埋め込まれていました。
Unit number 4 was not operating at that time of the earthquake and tsunami. All of the fuel was taken out of the reactor core and put into what we call the spent fuel pool. The spent fuel pool, however, as you can see, was on the fourth floor, and it's basically an area, a part of the building where there are no longer any walls or ceiling roof.
たくさんの放射性物質が原子炉の運転によって生み出されてきているのですが、その中で私が一番人類にとって危険を加えるだろうと思っているのはセシウム137という放射性物質です。
I know that all of you are aware of the fact that there are many radioactive materials that were emitted by this accident, and that there are many things that we must worry about. However, when nuclear power plants or reactors operate, they produce a great number of different types of radioactive materials. Of them, the one that I think is most dangerous to humanity is cesium-137.
この4号機の半分壊れた原子炉建屋の中に使用済み燃料プールが宙づりになっているのですが、そのプールの底には広島原爆に換算すると約1万4000発分のセシウム137が含まれていました。
I mentioned earlier that the reactor building for unit number 4 was very much destroyed, and the spent fuel pool was exposed to the air and sort of hanging in mid-air. In the spent fuel pool for reactor number 4, which was completely exposed to the air, there it was enough cesium-137 equivalent to 14,000 bombs that were dropped in Hiroshima. I'll say that again. There was enough cesium-137 in the spent fuel pool to that was equivalent to 14,000 hydrogen bombs, A bombs that were dropped on, Hiroshima.
それがプールの底で発熱を続けているわけで、プールの水が干上がってしまって燃料が溶けるようなことになれば、東京すら放棄するしかないと当時の原子力委員会の近藤俊介委員長が報告書を出しました。
There was a danger at that time that the spent fuel rods in that spent fuel pool might eventually, because it was, they were still continuing to emit heat, that eventually all the water in that pool would dry up. And if the pool water would all dry up, that would create a situation where the spent fuel rods would begin to melt it themselves. And that would create a terrible situation where probably people in the Tokyo area would have to evacuate as well. This is not just my personal opinion, but it was actually the opinion expressed in a report by Mr. Kondo, who was the head of the Nuclear Energy Commission at that time.
記者の皆さんはご記憶かもしれませんが、当日から数日間にわたって自衛隊のヘリコプターが福島第一原子力発電所に飛んでいって上空から水を落としたことがありましたし、東京消防庁が放水車で現場に駆けつけたこともありましたが、それらはこの4号機の中、4号機の使用済み燃料プールの中に何とかして水を補給しなければ東京が壊滅するというそのためでした。
I think many of you journalists in this room may remember that there were some days immediately following the accident where we had self-defense forces helicopters fly above the power plant to drop water onto the plant. And also we had members of the Tokyo Fire Department bring very, very long hoses and try to again put water into the plant. But actually what they were focusing on was unit number 4. They had to somehow keep that spent fuel pool filled with water. However, if they didn't, if they were not successful, they thought Tokyo could be destroyed.
そうしながらすでに4年が経ってしまいましたが、これも皆さんご記憶かもしれませんが、2011年という事故の起きた年には、民主党という政党が政権を握っていました。
So, things have continued at Fukushima Power Plant for the last 4 years, and many such some progress, some not. But you may remember that in 2011, the party in power was the Democratic Party of Japan.
12月になって、当時の野田首相という方が事故収束宣言というのを出しました。
You may also recall that in December of 2011, the Prime Minister at that time, Prime Minister Noda, made an official declaration that the accident at Fukushima nuclear power plant number one had been brought to a close. The Japanese terms 収束した。
私はその時にも冗談を言わないでくださいと思いました。
My reaction on hearing his words were, "Stop kidding."
事故からすでに4年経っていますが、残念ながら事故は全く収束できないままです。
The reality is that even though 4 years have passed, the accident situation has not yet been brought to a close at all.
先ほど聞いていただいたように、運転していなかった4号機の場合には使用済み燃料プールに広島原爆に換算すれば1万4000発分ものセシウムが眠ったままだったのです。危機がずっと続いていて、一刻も早くそれを何とかしなければいけない状態でした。そしてその危機に関しては東京電力も国も十分に知っていて、一刻も早く危機を除去しようと努めてきました。そして、2013年の11月から使用済み燃料プールの底の燃料を運び出す作業をようやくに始めて、2014年、昨年の11月に使用済み燃料プールから燃料を取り出して、少し危険が少ないであろう隣の共用燃料プールというところに移動を終えました。
As I said earlier, the biggest danger that everyone involved was aware of was the fact that the unit number four, the spent fuel, although it was not operating at the time of the accident, the greatest danger lay with unit number four, this spent fuel pool. As I mentioned earlier, there was a great deal of cesium, 14,000 times the amount of the bomb that was dropped on Hiroshima. That cesium was simply sitting in that pool, and if that cesium were to be released into the air, then that would be the greatest, gravest danger that could be presented to Tokyo and to Japan. This was a crisis situation. Something needed to be done about this, and everyone at TEPCO and everyone at the Japanese government knew how serious this situation was, and they truly made efforts to try to deal with this situation. But it was not until November of 2013 that finally the process of removing those spent fuel rods from the spent fuel pool at unit number four was gradually, it was begun, and it took about a year, and it was not until 2014 November, a year later, that all of the spent fuel rods were extracted from the unit number four pool and moved to a slightly less dangerous common spent fuel pool nearby.
このことに関しては私は本当にほっとしました。この作業が曲がりなりにも終わったということで、東京を放棄しなければいけないという事態は多分避けられただろうと私は思います。
I was so, so grateful and glad that this work was finally done and finished. I was relieved because I thought at last the possibility that Tokyo might have to be abandoned suddenly has at last been cleared. We've been able to discard that fear.
しかしそれで危機が去ったわけではありません。先ほど聞いていただいたように、2011年3月11日に運転していた1号機から3号機は原子炉が溶け落ちてしまったわけですが、その溶け落ちた炉心が今現在どこにどのような状態で存在しているか誰も分かりません。
Having said this, however, although this terribly great danger was somehow at least overcome for the time being, that does not mean that we're out of a crisis situation at all. As I mentioned, I've so far been talking about unit number four, but there's another great concern, which is what is the situation regarding units number one and three. As I mentioned, there was a meltdown of the core, but exactly what is the situation within the core, where, how much has melted, where is the fuel exactly, we do not know.
なぜなら4年経った今でも現場に行くことができないから です。人間が行けば即死します。そのためロボットを生かせようとしているのですが、ロボットも放射線というものに関しては大変弱いので、送り込んだロボットはみんな戻ってこれないという状態になっています。
Why do we not know what the situation is in these units number 1 to 3? It's because nobody can go to the site and see with their own eyes, can check with their own eyes. The radiation levels are so high that if a person were to try to go inside, that person would die immediately. Even robots which are now being employed to try to, to gauge the situation inside, they are very fragile when it comes to very high radiation levels. All of the robots that have been sent in have not been able to return as a result.
4年経っても現場に行くことができないというような事故は、原子力発電所以外には決して起きないという、そういう過酷な事故です。
I would like to impress upon you that this is an accident of a severity that cannot be imagined anywhere else. In other words, an accident, a terrible thing occurs, you're not able to go, even though 4 years have passed toclose by to the site to see what has happened. That kind of situation arises only with a nuclear power plant accident. There's no other similar situation.
仕方がないので、これ以上炉心を溶かすことは許されないというので、ひたすら4年間水を注入し続けています。
So as you can see, we are facing a very, very difficult situation, and the only choice that we have open to us is to somehow keep the situation from getting worse. And the only way that we can do that is to continually keep pumping water into the plant so that there is no overheating.
しかしそんなことをすれば、送り込んだ水が放射能で汚れた汚染水になってしまうということは避けようがありません。
But as you know, the more water we pump in, the more contaminated water, irradiated water we produce. We cannot avoid this terrible situation.
今現在も毎日300トンから400トンというような放射能汚染水が増加しています。それを何とか環境に出さなければいけないということで、労働者が福島第一原子力発電所の現場で苦闘しています。
Even today, every single day, 300 to 400 tons of contaminated water are being produced. And as a result of great efforts to keep this contaminated water from entering the more general environment, we have people on the site, workers on the site, working night and day to try to contain this.
その労働者たちは、もちろん東京電力の社員ではありません。下請け、孫請け、そのまた下請け、孫請け、8時、9時、10時というような多重な下請け関係の中で、労働者が賃金を受け取るときには最低賃金にも満たないと言われているような労働者が現場で苦闘しています。
When I talk about the workers who are working night and day to try to contain this situation, I'm not talking about TEPCO employees. There are no TEPCO employees doing that kind of dangerous work. It's not even the subcontractors who are doing this kind of work. It's the subcontractors. We go, there's a level of about 8, 9, maybe 10 layers, and it's the people at the very bottom who are actually doing the work, and it is said thatSo many commissions are taken from their salaries that they're not even receiving minimum wage.
皆さんもご存知だろうと思いますが、1986年に起きたチェルノブイリ原子力発電所の事故の場合には、60万人とも80万人とも言われる軍人、退役軍人、労働者、一部は囚人と言われているような人たちが事故の収束作業に駆り集められました。
I think you will all recall the terrible situation in Chernobyl in 1986 when they had their nuclear power plant accident. It has been said that anywhere from 600,000 to 800,000 people were called upon to try to deal with that situation. The 600,000 to 800,000 people included actual military personnel, also retired veterans, just general workers, and also it is said some convicts were recruited to take care of this situation.
この日本でそれだけ大量の労働者を確保できるかといえば多分できないだろうと思いますし、今現在もすでに外国人労働者が大量に福島に連れてこられています。
In Japan, would we be able to find that many people to deal with the situation? I do not think that is a possibility at all. In fact, as it is, we're already seeing a large number of foreign workers working at Fukushima.
今現在日本というこの国は自民党という政党が政権を取っていて、安倍さんという人が首相をやっていますが、安倍さんは何よりも経済最優先だということでオリンピックを誘致しようとしています。そのために 福島第一原子力発電所はアンダーコントロールだと彼は言ったわけですが、残念ながら未だに苦闘は続いていますし、これから労働者がどんどん被爆をしながら何年も何十年も戦わなければいけないというそういう状態になってしまっています。
As you know, Japan is now led by the administration, which is composed of the members of the ruling party, the LDP, and also the Prime Minister, Mr. Abe, a man who has very clearly set out as his main priority economic recovery, economic expansion. As a result, he has worked very hard to bring the Olympics to Japan. In order to make the Olympic bid successful, he gave a speech on the international stage where he declared that the Fukushima accident was under control. However, that is not the situation at all. On a daily basis, there are workers on the site who are struggling to somehow deal with the situation, and every day they are being irradiated. And this struggle, this daily struggle of the workers there will continue for years to come, for decades to come.
労働者の苦闘によってこれから環境に放出する放射性物質の量をなんとか少なくしなければいけないと私は思いますけれども、残念ながらすでに大量の放射性物質が環境に放出されてしまいました。
I've been explaining how much the workers on site have been struggling in spite of the irradiation they receive to try to contain the radioactive materials and try to keep the radioactive materials from being introduced into the environment. Having said this, in spite of their great efforts, there has unfortunately already been a great deal of radioactive materials that have been introduced into the environment.
今この瞬間も福島県を中心にした汚染地帯で人々が被爆をし続けているわけですが、その状況はこれから何年も何十年もあるいは何百年も続かざるを得ないという状況になっています。
Even as we sit here talking today, every single moment people in this area beginning centered primarily around the Fukushima prefecture area are receiving radiation and this being irradiated, being exposed to radiation situation will continue for years to come, for decades to come, possibly for centuries to come.
これが福島第一原子力発電所の上空からの写真です。
This is an aerial shot of the Fukushima plant.
1号機、2号機、3号機、4号機が北から南に並んでいます。その他5号機と6号機がもう少し北に2機あったのですが、この2機は本当に幸いなことに非常用発電機の1機が生き延びたために原子炉の炉心が溶け落ちるということは防がれました。そして1から4のこの部分の炉心が溶けたり、あるいは使用済み燃料プールが危機に陥ったりしたわけです。そして大量の放射性物質が噴き出してきて、あちこちの汚染を広げている。そして水をかけ続けているので放射能汚染水が増加しているわけですが、それを東京電力はとにかくタンクを作って溜め込もうとしてきました。それがここに一軍のタンク群としてどんどんどんどん膨れ上がってきているという状態です。今現在50万トンを超える放射能汚染水がこの中に溜まっています。
So this is an aerial shot. You can see units number 1 to 4 on the southern part of the slide, and then up above you have number 5 and number 6. Reactors number 5 and 6 don't come into the news very much. They were very fortunate because one emergency generator managed to operate that day, and so there was no meltdown of the core. However, as you can see, reactors number 1 to 4 have had all of these different problems, and they are a great deal of radioactive materials were therefore emitted into the air. And not only this, as I mentioned earlier, they constantly have to be kept cool. As a result, contaminated water is being produced in great amounts each day, and they are being put into, as you can see in that little square, these tanks. It was TEPCO's idea to somehow contain this water into these tanks. Already 500,000 tons of contaminated water are in these tanks.
いずれにしても福島第一原子力発電所の敷地には限りがありますので、タンクの増設も無限にできるわけではありませんし、あまり遠くない将来東京電力は放射能汚染水を海へ流すというそういうことになるだろうと私は思っています。
Although TEPCO is working hard to build tank after tank after tank, there is a limit to how much physical space there is available on this site for building of tanks. So I think in the not too distant future, TEPCO will have to make a decision and say that it will start releasing some of the contaminated water into the ocean.
そしてこういうタンクはほとんどが応急タンクです。きちっとしたタンクを作ろうとすれば労働者がどんどん被爆をしてしまいますので、応急タンクしか建設できないという状態で来ていますし、あちこちで漏れが進んでいます。その上、壊れてしまった原子炉建屋、タービン建屋などにも汚染水が溜まって、そこからどんどん日常的に放射能汚染水が敷地の中に漏れてきてしまって、今現在福島第一原子力発電所の敷地全体が放射能の沼のような状態になってしまっています。
So, I should also point out that although they are making these tanks are not really permanent solid tanks, but rather sort of provisional temporary tanks. The reason is that if one were to try to create, build more sturdy, solid permanent tanks, it means that during that process, the workers would be irradiated even more. There would be too much exposure to radiation, so they have to just simply manage with these tanks that are available. However, that means that because they were not designed for such long usage, we're seeing all sorts of leaks occur from time to time. And in addition to this, as you can see from the photograph, the reactor buildings, the turbine housing building also was damaged, and as a result, there's a great deal of water that goes through these facilities, and contaminated water therefore is leaking throughout the entire facility. In fact, we can look at all of Fukushima number one power plant, the whole facility, and say it's like a very highly contaminated swamp.
東京電力は福島第一原子力発電所の中の敷地の中にある井戸水を分析をしていましたが、ある井戸水、去年の10月に取った井戸水の分析結果を東京電力が公表しました。その結果、セシウム134が1リットルあたり6万1000ベクレル入っていたと公表しました。セシウム137が1リットルあたり19万ベクレル。ゼンベーターと私たちが呼んでいる放射性物質は1リットルあたり780万ベクレルあったということです。
So, as you can see from this slide, I mentioned that this whole entire facility was like a swamp, a contaminated swamp. TEPCO last year did some research. They took water samples from wells that were in the facility. And from one of the wells, they were able to get this kind of data. This was in October of last year. Cesium-134, 61,000 becquerels per liter, which is a huge, huge number, record high. And then cesium-137, 190,000 becquerels per liter. And of all of the, what we call the beta emissions, 77.8 million becquerels per liter.
日本の法律で環境に放出が許されているようなこれらの放射性物質の濃度はセシウム134の場合は1リットルあたり60ベクレル、6万1000ベクレルに比べれば、10倍、100倍、1000倍というそういう濃度のものが井戸水にありました。
What I'm showing you in red are the actual legally accepted emissions set by Japanese law. And as you can see, it's for cesium-134, it's only 60 becquerels per liter, which means that it's over 1,000 times the allowed limit.
セシウム137の場合の環境に放出していい濃度は1リットルあたり90ベクレルですから、この場合には10倍、100倍、1000倍、2000倍以上と。いうようなものがもう井戸水の中に溢れてきてしまっているという状態です。
So again, with cesium-137, the allowed limit is only 90 becquerels per liter, but it's 190,000 as becquerels per liter that were discovered in this well. So that's over 2,000 times the legal limit of emissions allowed into the environment.
さらにこのゼンベータと呼んでいる放射性物質の正体は、私はストロンチウム90だと思っていますが、ストロンチウム90の環境に放出していい良い濃度は1リッターあたり30ベクレルでしかありません。ですから何十万倍というような猛烈な放射能を含んだ汚染水が敷地の中にあって、それが井戸として組み上げられているという状態です。
And in regard to this terminology, total beta, I believe what they are referring to basically is the strontium-90 radioactive material, and the allowable limit is only 30 becquerels, and you can see it's 7.8 million that was discovered in this well. So it shows you that it's several tens of thousands of times the allowable limit that you are seeing on the site from a well.
こういう危機がこれからずっと続いていくし、その危機を少しでも なんとか乗り切るために労働者が被爆を続けるということになるわけです。
So again, we are in a very terrible situation. I would even call it a crisis situation. In order to ensure that the crisis does not get worse, the workers on site are working every single day and will continue to work every single day for the foreseeable future, even as they are exposed to further radiation.
その上もっと困難な課題が残っています。それは溶け落ちてしまった炉心をこれから一体どうするかということです。
However, although what I've been describing is quite grave, we have an even more serious issue facing us, which is the reactor cores have melted in units 1 to 3. What are we going to do about that?
東京電力と国はその溶け落ちた炉心をいつの時点かで外につまみ出して安全に保管するという工程表を書いています。
TEPCO and the Japanese government have recognized the problem, and they have said that, and they have put together a plan where they intend, in theory, to somehow pluck the melted fuel from the reactor cores and move them to a safer place where they will be stored and maintained.
これが東京電力が示した工程表のスライドで、日本語で大変申し訳ないのですが、簡単に説明させていただきます。
So I apologize for this slide being in Japanese. It's actually a slide that was presented by TEPCO. It presents their plan as to how they will pluck out the melted fuel.
東京電力の説明によると、溶け落ちた炉心は原子炉圧力容器の底に一部が残り、そして格納容器の床の上にまんじゅうのように堆積していると彼らは主張しています。
So as was just explained right here, as he pointed out, on the left-hand diagram, in the very center you have the pressure vessel, and surrounding the pressure vessel in the center you have the containment vessel. And what TEPCO is saying is that inside the pressure vessel, which is that smaller part at the top, in the middle of the diagram, you have at the bottom the melted fuel, and they believe that the melted fuel has gone through the bottom of the pressure vessel and gone all the way down to the floor of the containment vessel, and it's sitting there sort of like in a big lump.
今現在は圧力容器、格納容器という放射能を閉じ込める最後の防壁として設計されたこの容器もすでに破壊されてしまっていて、いくら水を入れても中に水がたまらないという状態になっています。
So you have that sort of test tube-like round object that he was just pointing out, which is the containment vessel. And the containment vessel was supposed to be sort of the last fortress of defense to protect people from radiation. However, it seems that there has been damage to the containment vessel because no matter how much water you pump in, it keeps not filling up.
東京電力はいつの時点かで圧力容器の底に残っている燃料と格納容器の底に落ちた燃料を上方向に取り出そうとしています。
So, as you can see from how the professor has pointed, at the bottom of the smaller pressure vessel and at the bottom of the larger containment vessel, they believe, typical believes that there are lumps of melted fuel. And they have this idea that they are somehow going to insert something from the top of the pressure vessel, go through all the way down to the bottom of the containment vessel, and pluck out all of these lumps of melted fuels.
しかしこの状態で圧力容器の蓋を開けてしまうと、大量の放射線が下から上方向に飛び出してきてしまって、全く作業ができません。
However, if they were simply to try to remove the top of the pressure vessel in a dry state and put something inside, that means the moment they opened it up, there would be a huge amount of radioactive materials that would be emitted into the air. Nobody could go even close.
そのため東京電力は今は壊れてしまっている格納容器をまず補修して格納容器全体に水が張れるようにすると言っています。
So how is TEPCO going to deal with this situation? They are saying that the first step they will take is to somehow plug the holes in the containment vessel, the larger vessel. Obviously, there must be some damage. So once they are able to repair the size of the containment vessel, then they will fill it with water.
その上で上の方から機器を下に挿入していって圧力容器の中にある燃料あるいは格納容器の中にまんじゅうのようにたまっていた燃料を上につかみ出すというのが東京電力と国の計画です。
And after the containment vessel has been flooded with water, then they will insert some equipment from above and go through the pressure vessel and also go all the way down to the bottom of the containment vessel and pluck the spent fuel, which they insist is all in a lump. And the terminology that the description that the professor is using is it looks like a dumpling. It's all together in a mass.
しかし、こんな作業は決してできない。と私は思います。何よりもまずは穴の開いている格納容器をきちっと調べることが困難を極めていますし、どこに穴が開いているかということが分かっても、それを補修することすらできないだろうと思います。
But I believe that this plan that has been presented is simply impossible to realize. The reason for this is that, first of all, the containment vessel does have holes. We don't even have the technology or ability now to even, first of all, determine where the holes are. And even if we were able to determine where the holes are, how can we possibly repair them? We do not have the means to do so, I believe.
仮にその補修ができて水が格納容器の中に蓄えられるようになったとしても実は溶け落ちた燃料は格納容器の床の上にまんじゅうのように堆積しているというようなことは決してないと私は思います。
I also think that if hypothetically one were able to, to repair the size of the containment vessel and successfully fill it with water, then even if you were to try to pluck out the melted fuel from above, I think the fundamental sort of assumption of TEPCO and the government that the melted fuel is sitting at the bottom in a nice little lump, like a dumpling shape, I think that is impossible. It's an impossible proposition.
事故は非常に過酷な状態でドラスティックに進行したわけで、溶け落ちた燃料はもうそこら中に格納容器内に散らばってしまっている、あるいはすでに格納容器の床を突き抜ける、あるいは横方向を突き破ってそこら中に散らばっていると私は思いますので、この絵にあるように上方向から機器を入れて掴み出せる燃料の量などというものは知れていると思います。
What I'm trying to say is that although this picture looks like a neat little situation where all of the spent fuel is put very nicely into two little lumps, I think when one considers the severity of the accident that occurred and all of the explosions and shaking and etc. and damage that occurred, I cannot imagine that all of the every bit of that melted fuel will be sitting nicely in one little lump, but rather if they will have spread all over the place. And it's also possible not only will they have spent spread horizontally, it could be that some of the spent fuel could actually have gone through the floor of the containment vessel as well.
そのことは原子力の専門家であればみんなわかるはずだと私は思いますし、最近になって福島県の新聞がこのような記事を出しました。今聞いていただいたように溶け落ちた燃料が圧力容器の真下の格納容器の床にまんじゅうのように溜まっているようなことはなくて、もうそこら中に散乱してしまっていると、国の方の研究者も認めているという、そういう情報です。
What I've just described is very, very logical for anyone who understands nuclear engineering or nuclear energy. And in recent months, it has come to the understanding of the general public. In fact, this is a copy of a local Fukushima newspaper which printed an article about what I just described. Instead of the government or TEPCO's previous explanation of the melted fuel being in one dumpling nice shape, rather it shows that probably they have come, they're spread all over the place horizontally. In the area. And in fact, this is the result of some announcements of analysis by even government sanctioned experts.
結局、溶け落ちた燃料の取り出しということはできないと私は思いますし、チェルノブイリ原子力発電所でやったように、石棺というもので封じ込めるしかないだろうと思います。
In other words, if TEPCO and the Japanese government try to pluck out the melted fuel from above, they might be able to get some of it, but there is no way that they will be able to get all of it. So I believe that this is, I think fundamentally, the idea of trying to somehow remove the melted fuel from the containment or pressure vessels is simply impossible to realize. And the only possible way we can eventually deal with this accident is to do what was done in Chernobyl, which is to create a concrete coffin or sarcophagus for the facility.
しかし1号機、2号機、3号機にも4号機と同じように使用済み燃料プールがあって、そのプールの中に未だに使用済みの燃料が沈んだままです。それを何とかして掴み出さない限りは石棺を作ることすらができません。
However, as I mentioned earlier, when there was a problem of the spent fuel pool in unit number 4. A similar situation is present for units number 1 to 3. They also have spent fuel pools, which are filled with spent fuels, and they also have to be plucked out and removed. Otherwise, we cannot even think about building a sarcophagus or a concrete coffin.
1号機、2号機、3号機の使用済み燃料プールの底から燃料を少しでも危険の少ない場所に移すまでに何年かかるのか私も分かりませんし、東京電力も国もほとんど分かっていないだろうと思います。
So I mentioned how long it took for the spent fuel rods to be moved to a slightly less dangerous place from unit number 4. But in regard to units number 1 to 3, how long will it take for the spent fuel rods to be removed to a slightly less dangerous place? We have no idea. I think TEPCO and Japanese government really do not know how long this procedure will take.
その後石棺を作る作業に着手するわけで、一体石棺というものが何年後にできるのか、それすらが分かりませんし、多分私は死んでしまっているのではないかと自分で思います。
So it is only after the spent fuel rods have been removed, safely removed, to another place that a sarcophagus or concrete coffin can eventually be made. How many years from now will that be done? I cannot evenbegin to make a prediction. In fact, I probably will not be alive when the project starts.
仮にその石棺ができたとしても、皆さんもご承知の通り、チェルノブイリ原子力発電所では29年経った今、初め作った石棺がボロボロになって、第二石棺というものを作ろうという作業が進んでいます。
Even if this kind of a concrete coffin or container is eventually made, as you know, with Chernobyl, it's been 29 years since the accident, and the first sort of concrete coffin that they made surrounding the reactor is now aging, and there are cracks and much damage appearing, so they're making another secondary one to surround it.
チェルノブイリで壊れた原子炉はたった1基ですけれども、福島第一原子力発電所では、少なくとも1号機、2号機、3号機という3つの原子炉が溶け落ちてしまっているわけで、これから何十年、あるいは何百年という期間にわたって放射能を閉じ込めるという作業をしなければいけません。
So, although the Chernobyl accident was a terrible accident, it only involved one reactor. With Fukushima, we have at the minimum numbers 1 to 3, three reactors that are emitting dangerous radiation. So the way to deal with this accident, the work involved in dealing with this accident will take tens of years, hundreds of years. The radioactive materials must be contained on a centuries-based timeline.
これがこれから戦いを続けなければいけない課題ですけれども、すでに放出されてしまった放射性物質にどうやって向き合うかという課題も現に存在しています。福島第一原子力発電所の事故で、どれだけの放射性物質が環境に放出されたかということに関しては、日本国政府が IAEA、国際原子力機関に報告書を出していますので、その数字を今から見ていただこうと思います。
So far, I've been talking about the future problems that we face, how to contain the radioactive materials in the future. But as I mentioned earlier, some radioactive materials have already, unfortunately, been emitted into the environment. How much? The figures I'm showing you are actually figures that were presented by the Japanese government in a report that they presented to the IAEA.
私が見ていただくのは、先ほど聞いていただいたセシウム137という放射性物質がどれだけ放出されたかというデータです。
So what I'm going to be showing you is the amount of cesium-137 that was actually released into the atmosphere.
左の下に今黄色い四角を書きましたが、これは1945年8月6日に日本に落とされた広島原爆がどれだけのセシウム137を大気中に放出したかというデータです。黄色の四角の大きさでそれを表しています。
So, you can see here, I've put a little yellow square that shows you the amount of cesium-137 that was released into the atmosphere as a result of the dropping of the bomb on Hiroshima.
数字はテラベクレルという単位で示した放射能の量です。
So the unit of measurement is terabecquerels.
福島第一原子力発電所の事故の場合には、1号機だけで広島原爆の6発分から7発分のセシウム137を大気中に放出したと日本国政府が言っています。
For the Fukushima accident, even just with unit number one, So from 6 to 7 times is the amount of the unit number one released, 6 to 7 times the amount of C-137 that was emitted by the bomb that was dropped in Hiroshima.
一番大量に放射性物質を吹き出したのは2号機だと国と東京電力が言っています。3号機もやはり吹き出させて、当日運転中だった1号機2号機3号機を合わせると、広島原爆が放出したセシウム137の168発分を環境にばらまいたと東京電力、あ、日本国政府が言っているのです。
And again, I repeat, this is data that is provided by the Japanese government. It was number, unit number 2 that released the most amount, the largest amount of cesium-137 into the atmosphere. Number three also released some as well. But taken together, units number one, two, and three released 168 times the amount of cesium-137 that was emitted by the Hiroshima bomb.
そしてこれは大気中にばらまいたというセシウムだけであって、先ほど聞いていただいたように、今現在も放射能汚染水としてどんどん海へ流しているという事故が進行しているわけです。つまり福島第一原子力発電所の事故というのは、広島原爆の何百発分というような放射性物質を環境にまき散らし、今現在もまき散らし続けている事故だということです。
I would like to again point out to you, this is simply the amount of C-137 that was emitted into the atmosphere, into the air, as a result of this accident. But as I've explained in some detail already, every day more contaminated water is being produced, contaminated water is being unfortunately going into the ocean. The final amount of C-137 that have been emitted into the atmosphere or into the environment as a result of the Fukushima number one plant accident is several hundred times the equivalent of what was emitted by the Hiroshima bomb. And it is an ongoing process. It is not yet finished.
吹き出して大気中に吹き出してきた放射性物質はどうなるかといえば、風に乗って流れるだけです。結局どんなふうに放射性物質が汚染を広げていったかというと、これはフランスの研究機関のデータですけれども、こんなように汚染を広げたと考えられています。
And so when the first explosions occurred and a great deal of radioactive materials were emitted into the air, where did they go? Well, obviously, the wind blew them in certain directions. This data is presented by a French research institution. It shows you where the radioactive materials flew.
ここは日本で、赤いところが一番汚染の強いところ、その周りに黄色いところが東北地方、関東地方にありますが、少し汚染の少ないところ、それから青いところがありますが、ここが汚染のもっと少ないところです。汚染の程度は右のところに書いてありますが、赤が一番汚染が強い、黄色が汚染が少ない、だんだん汚染が少なくなるに従って青くなるという色分けをしてあります。
So as you can see, the red portion is the area surrounding Fukushima, and as you can see on the right-hand side,There's a set scale, a color scale that shows you the degree of radiation. The red is very bad, yellow is slightly less worse, and then it goes down to blue, which is fairly good. But you can see that the Fukushima area is in bright red, and surrounding it are yellow areas, which include the Tokyo and Greater Kanto Plain areas, and then the rest of Japan, which is in lighter blue.
もちろん日本の東北地方、関東地方は猛烈に汚れているわけですけれども、日本というこの国は北半球温帯という地域に属していて、上空では偏西風という強い西風が吹いています。
As you can see, the Tohoku or northeastern part of Japan, the Kanto Great Plain where Tokyo rests, this area was very much contaminated. But you also have to take into account a more world view. Japan is a nation that is located in the temperate zone of the northern hemisphere. It is an area where there are very strong winds blowing from the west. We call them the prevailing westerlies.
そのため福島から吹き出してきた放射性物質は偏西風に乗って太平洋の方向に流れていって、北アメリカ大陸の西海岸を強く汚染しています。
So as you can see, the prevailing westerlies blew from the west very strong winds, and it blew the cesium-137 across the Pacific Ocean and contaminated much of the western coast of North America.
一つの事故がその現場だけではなくて、地球全体に及ぶような汚染を引き起こす というようなものもやはり原子力発電所以外には起きないはずだと思います。
And I believe also this is an example of why nuclear power plant accidents are different from any other kinds of accidents or any other kinds of events. It's not only the site itself that is severely damaged and severely contaminated and severely hurt, but the effects, the negative impacts of the accident spread throughout the world.
ともあれ日本国内は強い汚染を受けました。上空では偏西風が吹いていたとしても、地上では南風の日もある、北風の日もある、東風の日もあるわけですから、東北地方を中心にして、このような汚染が生じたと、日本国政府が地図を公表しています。
And this is again data that has been presented by the Japanese government. Although the prevailing westerlies might have blown a great deal of cesium-137s towards the Pacific Ocean, more down toward the ground level, you have winds blowing in all kinds of directions, some blow north, some blow west, east, and south. As a result, you can see how much, how large an area has been contaminated.
赤、黄、緑と色分けしたこの地域が猛烈な汚染を受けた地域で、今現在も10万人を超える人たちがふるさとを追われて流浪化してしまっています。
And so the area in the center, which are indicated by the colors red, yellow, and green, this is the most highly contaminated area. As a result, over 100,000 people are not able to return to their homes.
その他にも汚染はもちろん生じていて、青く塗ったところ、あるいはくすんだ緑で塗ったところというのがあちこちにありますが、こういうところは一番汚染の少ないところでも1平方メートルあたり3万ベクレルを超えて放射能で汚れています。
You also see some areas indicated in blue and then also some spots that have been scattered that are in dark green. The radiation levels are very, very high there, if something on the order of 30,000 becquerels per square meter.
日本には放射能に関する法律がたくさんありまして、放射能を取り扱う場所は放射線管理区域という地域に指定して、その中で厳密に取り扱えということになってきました。
In Japan, there are very, very strict rules and many strict laws that govern the use and handling of radiation. And the areas where radiation is an issue or there is high radiation levels, they're indicated as radiation control areas. It's a special designation, legal designation.
その放射線管理区域から何か物を持ち出すときには1平方メートルあたり4万ベクレルを超えているようなものはどんなものでも持ち出してはいけないというのが日本の法律でした。
So the law that existed was that if you are taking an object, regardless of what that object might be, if you're taking an object out of a radiation control area to a place that is outside of that area, then regardless of what that object is, if it produces over 40,000 becquerels per square meter, you cannot remove that object from that radiation control area.
放射線管理区域というのは普通の皆さんは立ち入ることすらが禁じられる場所ですし、私のような職業的な労働者であっても中に入ったが最後水すら飲めないというそういう場所です。
The radiation control area has many, many strict rules so that average people such as yourselves are not legally allowed to enter this area. And even for people like, such as myself who are experts or somehow working related to this field, even though we're allowed to go inside this area, we cannot even take a sip of water.
その放射線管理区域の外側には1平方メートルあたり4万ベクレルを超えて汚れているようなものはどんなものでも存在してはいけないというのがこれまでの法律だったのですが、この青いところは1平方メートルあたり6万ベクレルをすでに超えてしまっていますし、くすんだ緑のところも3万ベクレルから6万ベクレルという汚染を受けているのです。
So until now, there were very strict rules about radiation control areas. It was said that, again, to repeat, you could not take anything out of this area that produced over 40, that was contaminated to the point of 40,000 becquerels per square meter. In fact, anything with more than that radiation level could not exist outside of the radiation control areas. Having said this, however, the areas indicated in blue already have objects that are irradiated to the level of over 60,000 becquerels per square meter, and the spots indicated in dark green have from 30,000 to 60,000 becquerels per square meter.
日本が法律を守るというなら、およそ1万4000平方キロメートルに及ぶ場所を放射線管理区域にしなければいけないほどに汚れていると、日本国政府自身が地図で示しているのです。
In other words, if one is going to be very strict about the letter of the law and say that anything over the allowed limit must be kept in an area that is the radiation control area, then Japan must designate 14,000 square kilometers of Japan to be radiation control areas.
しかし日本国政府は原子力緊急事態宣言を出して、今は緊急事態だから法律を守らなくてもいいということにして、人々をこの汚染地に捨ててしまったのです。
However, the Japanese government has issued a declaration that this is an emergency situation. As a result, normal laws do not have to be followed. What they are saying, therefore, is that in these very high irradiated radiation exposure level areas, they have basically abandoned people to live there. They've actually thrown them away to live there, is what the professor said.
今、放射性のセシウムが大気中に放出された広島原爆の168倍だと日本国政府が言っていると私は言いました。その量が1万5000テラベクレルという放射能の単位です。
So I said earlier that the amount of C-137 that have been emitted into the atmosphere is equivalent to the amount that was emitted by the Hiroshima bomb, 168 times that amount. This is data that was announced by the Japanese government. If we put it into becquerels, it's 15,000 terabecquerels.
その大部分が偏西風に乗って太平洋の方向に流れて行きました。そして一部分が日本の東北地方、関東地方に降り注いだわけですが、その量は約2400テラベクレルです。
Most of that which went up into the atmosphere were pushed by the prevailing westerlies over the Pacific. However, a great deal fell on the Tohoku region and on, landed in the Kanto Plain area, and that amount is 2400 terabecquerels.
今私は放射能の単位でセシウム137の量を皆さんに聞いていただいたのですが、このセシウム137を重量にする、重さで測ったらどれだけになると思われるでしょうか。
I'm sure a little, some of you may not really be able to imagine what this amount really represents. In other words, I talk about 15,000 terabecquerels or 2,400 terabecquerels. If we looked at this in terms of actual weight of the material, radioactive materials, how much do you think that would actually be in weight?
福島第一原子力発電所がまき散らしたセシウム137は全量でも 4.7 キログラムしかありません。
All of the cesium-137s that were emitted by the Fukushima power plant accident is equivalent to 4.7 kilograms.
日本の東北地方、関東地方を中心に広大な地域を放射線管理区域にしなければいけないほど汚染したセシウム137の重量はわずか750グラムです。
And I mentioned earlier that the C-137s that had fallen onto Japanese territory, Japanese land in the Tohoku and Kanto regions, so much so that this area should all be put under the radiation control area designation. All of that put together is only 750 grams in weight.
放射能は人間の五感で感じられないとよく言われますけれども、当たり前です。感じられるほど放射能があれば人間なんて簡単に死んでしまうという、そういう生き物なのです。
It is often said that radioactivity or radiation is something that is very difficult to sense using any of the five senses, and that's only a normal, that makes sense, because if you were able to actually sense the radioactive materials, it would be of such an amount that you would immediately die.
そういう汚染の中で今福島を中心にした人たちが被爆をし続けているわけですが、なんとか被爆を少しでも少なくしたいと言って、自分の家の周り、学校の校庭とかいうところから土を剥いで集めています。もちろん電波の土は全部剥ぎ取るということもできませんし、山の汚染を剥ぎ取ることもできないのです。ごくごく一部の汚染を剥ぎ取って、こういう袋に詰めて、積み上げて来ています。何千万袋というような袋が汚染地帯にこんな形で積み上げられて、どんどんどんどん今現在も増えてしまっています。
So as I've said, people living in these contaminated areas are being exposed to radiation every single day, every single moment, and it is only natural that human nature would step in and people would try to take some action to try to diminish that exposure level, even a little bit. As a result, people have worked very, very hard to remove the topsoil around their homes, on school grounds. They can't remove all of the topsoil from all of the mountains, all of the parks, all of the land, all of the fields, but at least around their everyday lives, they're trying to remove that. And they put the contaminated soil into these big bags. There are tens of millions of such bags already.
しかし、これは袋ですので、どんどんどんどん破れてきます。実際にはこんなように、一度は詰めたつもりでも中から植物が袋を突き破って外に出てくるということになっていて、この袋をこれから一体どうやって管理をしていくのかということが今の課題になっていますし、これから何十年も何百年もこういう放射能に向き合わなければいけないという状態になっています。
But these bags are only a temporary solution. As you can see, some of the topsoil which was collected into the bags contained seeds of weeds, and the weeds eventually grew and basically broke through the sides of the bags, and you can see that they're growing very healthily. So how are we going to be able to manage these bags? This is a topic that is not only pressing for us now, but also 10 years from now, 20 years from now, hundreds of years from now.
時間を大幅に超過してしまいましたが、福島の事故は未だに進行中だということを皆さんにも分かっていただきたいと思います。終わりにします。ありがとうございました。
I do apologize. I do apologize for having gone over time so much, but I really did want to impress upon you that the accident effects are still continuing. Thank you very much for your kind attention.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Koide. This event is actually scheduled until 4 o'clock, but if there's anyone from the working press who is dying to ask a question, then please do. Okay, go ahead. Okay.
I'm really fascinated by your presentation.
Can
my question.
Yourself? Can you identify yourself?
I'm Khalil Hassan, Ambassador of Bahrain. If you are the Prime Minister of Japan, what you are going to do with this very complicated situation?
Bahrain no Taishi de gozaimasu. もし先生が安倍首相でございましたら、何をする、どういう対策を取りますでしょうか、この問題に対して。
対策はたくさんやらなければいけないことがありますが、まずは汚染水というものの増加を防がなければいけないし、その環境への漏れというものを防がなければいけません。そのためにやるべきことは私は2つだと思っています。まずはこれまではただひたすら水を注入することで溶け落ちた炉心をこれ以上溶かさないということをやっていたのですが、水での冷却ということを諦める。私の場合は金属ということが候補として挙げていますし、場合によっては空冷も可能だと思っていますので、それをまずやるべきだと思います。
I think there are many, many things that I could do, countermeasures that I could take. The first, most pressing problem that is facing us today is somehow try to stop the increase of contaminated water that is being produced every day. And we also have to ensure that this contaminated water does not seep into the environment. In order to achieve this, I think there are two things that are necessary. First of all, measure that has been taken by TEPCO and the Japanese government is to keep pouring water onto the reactor core so that no more melting will occur. But I think a decision has to be to give up using water as a cooling element. I'm thinking of alternatives such as specific metals, and also by in special circumstances, it might be that we could use air cooling as well.
次にはすでに敷地の中が放射能の沼のような状態になってしまっていると私は先ほど聞いていただきましたが、その沼のような水が環境に出ていくことを防がなければいけませんので、原子炉建屋周辺に地下にダムを張り巡らせるということをやらなければいけないと私は思って、2011年5月からその主張を続けています。
The second thing that needs to be done is, I said earlier that the entire Fukushima nuclear power plant facility is basically like a radioactive swamp. And if you have a swamp area, you must ensure that somehow that water from that swamp does not seep into the surrounding environment. So what needs to be done immediately is to create an underwater dam that will completely surround all of the reactor buildings. This is something that I've been saying, espousing from May of 2011.
そのことは国も東京電力も再建になってようやく気がついてきて地下にダムを作る。ただしそのダムは凍土壁という土を凍らせて作るんだという計画を公表しています。
It seems that in recent months, at last, the government and TEPCO have begun to understand that there is this necessity for a wall, as I have been recommending. However, they have decided to embark on the building of a dam, but it is a very strange dam. It's a wall that is basically frozen soil.
しかしその凍土壁というのは深さが30メートル、長さは 1.4 キロというような凍った壁を作らなければいけないわけで、そんなものは決してできないと私は思います。
But what is going to be necessary is a huge wall. It's going to have to be 30 meters deep and it's going to have to be 1.4 kilometers long. I do not believe that such a frozen soil wall is possible to build.
やはりコンクリートと鋼鉄の、遮水壁ダムを作らなければいけないと思いますし、早急にそういうような形で対策を講じていくべきだと思います。
I believe what is necessary therefore is to create a truly strong and sturdy and dependable wall that is made of concrete and steel, reinforced steel, and I think that kind of a dam or underground dam or wall needs to be made immediately.
ご質問に対して今はあまりにもテクニカルなお答えになったかもしれませんので、もう少し基本的なことをこれからお答えしたいと思います。
So that was a very technical answer to your question, but I'd like to now talk in more general terms about some of the countermeasures I would take.
事故は残念ながら起きてしまいました。そしてその日に原子力緊急事態宣言というものが出されて、4年以上経った今も緊急事態宣言は解除されていない。のです。だからこそ日本の法律では許されないような場所に人々を捨てるというようなことも今現在行われているのです。
First of all, when immediately after the accident occurred, a declaration was issued by the government saying that this accident was an emergency situation. And when you have an emergency situation legally declared, that means that regular laws are put on hold. What that means is that people can be thrown away into areas where normally people should not be.
日本の国家にとって一番大切なことは自分が出した原子力緊急事態宣言というものを撤回できるように最大限の努力をするということだと私は思いますし、オリンピックなどに浮かれている時ではないのだと思います。
I think if the Japanese government should do everything in its power to be able to create a situation where it can lift this emergency situation declaration. In other words, I believe that they should not be thinking so much about happy events like the Olympics at a time like this.
ご質問では私が安倍さんだったらという仮定でご質問をいただきましたが、もし私が安倍さんであれば、まず真っ先にやることは子どもたちを汚染地帯から避難させるということです。
Your question also said, was that if I were Prime Minister Abe, what would be the first thing that I would do? The first thing I would do as Prime Minister is remove, evacuate all of the children who are in the contaminated areas.
やらなければいけないことは山ほどあって、すべてお答えする時間はないと思いますので、まずこれでよければ、次のご質問に移りたいと思います。
Of course, there are many, many other things I'd like to do, but I will stop here and take the next question.
Okay. じゃあ藤田さん。
フリーのジャーナリストの藤田博之と申します。Scientists for Accurate Radiation Information SARI というですね、科学者の団体がありまして、例えばオックスフォード大学のウェイド・アリソン先生、放射ノート理性という本を出されてますけど、そういった科学者の知見を聞きますと、その年100ミリシーベルト程度の、低線量放射線は健康に害を及ぼすどころか、むしろそのがんが減るとかですね、健康にいいという、そういうようなことを言われてるんですね。でその観点に立つとですね、もちろんその除染も必要ないし、子どもたちは学校の校庭で元気よく外で遊んだりいいし、汚染水もですね、全然ためる必要がないと、でもすぐ全部水流し、もう海に流したらいいと。でその放射線が、今すごい放射線量が空気中に出たと言ってもですね、放射線量は低線量、全然健康問題ないと、でがんにもならないと、みんなというようなことになるんですが、そういう、結構そういう人増えてるんですよ今。その辺どう思ってらっしゃいますか。
あまりにも愚かな主張だと 思います、人類が放射線を発見したのは1895年で、それ以降たくさんの、放射線被曝と健康への研究が積み重ねられてきました、その結果現在の学問の到達点としては被曝というものはどんなに低低いものであっても必ず健康に影響があるというのが現在の学問の定説なのです。だからこそこの地球上でほとんど全ての国に放射線の被曝に関する法律の規制があるというそういうことになっているわけです。日本の場合も被曝には危険が伴うから一般の方々は1年間に1ミリシーベルトしか被曝をしてはいけないという法律があるわけだし、私のような放射線業務従事者という労働者であっても1年間に20ミリシーベルト以上の被曝はしてはいけないということを法律で定めているわけです。それが全く間違いで被曝は健康にいいんだというのであれば法律でそういう制限を撤廃するというのがまず初めにやるべきことだと私は思いますし、世界中の国々がそういう法律を決めている以上は法律の定めに乗って国をきちっと運営するというのが国の責任だと私は思います。
So the question was about an association called Scientists for Accident Radiation. Is that atomic radiation? And it is represented by some famous scientists, such as professors of Oxford, etc. And the general tone of the scientists is that the general conclusion of these scientists is that with low levels of radiation, such as 100 millisieverts per year, this is not necessarily bad for one's health. It might even actually be good for one's health, and it's not necessarily something that would cause cancer. There's no reason to keep this contaminated water in tanks. It could just be released into the environment. There's no reason to decontaminate areas. Kids in that area can play outside freely. So what do you think about, and these scientists are not alone. They seem to be gaining more and more supporters. What do you think about this? The response is that I think it is an extremely foolish way of looking at this matter. Radioactive materials, or the idea of radiation, was discovered in 1942. And since then, a great deal of research has been done on the effects of radioactivity and radiation on humans. And the result is more or less accepted by the scientific community, which is that regardless of how low level radiation you are speaking about, there are always negative effects on living beings. And that is the basis of the many, many laws that exist in almost all countries of the world that limit radiation exposure that is allowed. For example, in Japan, it's only 1 millisievert per year of radiation exposure that is allowed for the average person. Even for someone such as myself, a specialist in this field who is exposed to more radiation than the average person, we're only allowed to have 20 millisieverts of radiation exposure each year. So people who say that it's good for your health, that you don't have to worry about these things, then I think the first thing they should do, if they really believe this, is work to remove these restrictions, these laws in all the countries of the world. But so long as these laws exist on the books, I believe it is the responsibility of each government to abide by them.
Okay, I'm sorry, we're going to have to wrap this up because club needs to prepare for the evening event. So, but Mr. Koide has agreed to stay until about 4:30. So we have interview room down the hallway, and he'll be around to take your questions if anyone is still interested in asking him questions. And as a customary, I'd like to present Mr. Koide the 1 year honorary membership. And since he has retired from Kyoto University, I'm sure he'll be seeing us. We'll be seeing him around here.
Thank you very much.
Okay, well, this is it. Thanks for coming for the press conference.
Thank you very much.